In 4 short years, J. Cole has come a long way. In 2009, at just 24, the artist from Fayetteville, North Carolina, became the first to sign with Jay-Z's Roc Nation record label. This year, after a few false starts, he released his second album, Born Sinner, which is already a smashing success, selling almost 300,000 copies in the U.S. in its first week. Guest star met up with the rap game perfectionist who told us how he went about creating his latest masterpiece.
Rap music, hip-hop is competitive, super competitive, you know what I mean? And if you want to be at the top, you got to go through a lot of people, and you have to prove dominance over a lot of people. Like, it's not a cakewalk. You have to always be on the top of your game and sharpen your skills if you want to remain at the top.
J. Cole started rapping at the age of 12. What started out as a hobby with his cousin soon became his passion. His taste in music slowly evolved and refined itself, helping him to find his voice and his calling as a storyteller.
I come from a school where, like, that was important. Like, lyrics was important, and like the way you craft words and the way your lines flow and the way your stories are told and the pictures you paint are important, so I still represent that.
As a teen, Jermaine Cole filled entire notebooks with his rhymes and posted songs online under the pseudonym Therapist. After graduating from high school, J. Cole released his first mixtape, The Come Up. He went on to release two more, The Warm Up in 2009 and Friday Night Lights in 2010, which both met with considerable success. 1 year later, he dropped his first studio album, Cole World, The Sideline Story, both a critical and commercial success. In June 2013, his highly anticipated second album came out after some delay, fine-tuning or fear of a sophomore jinx.
Born Sinner is my second album, and the reason why I can't have a sophomore jinx is because it's my second album, but it's really like my fourth album. You know what I mean? I came up in the mixtape world where my mixtapes were like albums. You know what I mean? So I was making mixtapes that you go listen to, The Warm Up, Friday Night Lights. These are albums. And one day I'm going to release them for commercial release because they deserve to be so. I'm a master of the beats and the rhymes. I'm rapping for the freaks and the dimes. And I shine like a motherfucking diamond. You shine like a motherfucking dime. That's word to my mom. I don't mind if y'all niggas hate. Know you hating on that nigga, nigga, get it straight. I'm spitting hungry like ain't shit up on my dinner plate. The kind of flow to make a nigga hyperventilate. This is really like my fourth album. That's why the sophomore jinx is impossible for me. And not to mention, even if it was, like, nah, this album is too good to, like, even fall victim to that. You know what I mean? So the album is phenomenal, man. I'm, like, very proud of the work I did, but it's been a year and a half. I took my time on it.
Over the course of a grueling year and a half, the artist looked into every aspect of the album. In addition to writing, J. Cole also handled production work on Born Sinner, a challenge of epic proportions. Nas wrote the Bible. Now what you're about to hear is a tale of glory and sin.
No, I beat my mentor and I let the story begin. I used to print out. I feel like I bring so much more to the table than just rap. Like, when it comes, you put me head to head with any rapper, I feel like I'm gonna win that day, you know what I'm saying? But then you gotta remember, like, you put me head to head with any producer, I'm also feeling like I'm gonna win that day. Now, I felt like that before. I felt like I had the tools, but there were certain tricks and things I was missing. Now I've learned all that, you know what I mean? Like, the quality of my beats, and this is over the years.
So I'm in the crib, rocking. Oh, and then I added the 808. Rocking though, I knew. Everything was building and I knew. Every step up until it hit a certain point. Like the 808, I knew right away I had to add it. I don't know what this is.
Like, it's a lot of work, and it all paid off in the end. It all pays off. Even what you hear on the album, I did 30 more of those songs, you know what I mean? And produced them from bottom up, from kick drum to the snare drum to the sample to the keys on top, you know what I mean? So it's an exhausting, even talking about it is exhausting. You can imagine, I gotta make these beats and then write the raps, but it's so rewarding in the end. You know what I mean? Like, it's a rewarding feeling to be able to press play on that album and know, like, damn, I made that beat right there. And I remember the whole process. I remember when I made that pattern and found that sample, like, it's a rewarding payoff rather than just a rapper who gets the beat, writes the rap, push the hook, and then let somebody else mix it. I'm there from step one all the way to the end, and that way my DNA is all in your ears. Like, I got so much better and hit a zone where I learned so much and was trying, trying new things. It was a great experience, man. Like, I wouldn't have it any other way, not for this album.
This need to rise to challenges is what prompted the young artist to move the release date of his album forward to coincide with that of one of his heroes, Kanye West. At 18, J. Cole was attending West's first headlining shows in New York and sampling his tracks on his mixtapes. 10 years down the line, he's neck and neck with him in the charts.
I couldn't pass the opportunity to do it, man. I'm a competitor. Like, I mean, at first, like, it was a joke. I was talking to Wale, matter of fact. And we both coming on June 25th. And I think Kanye had just tweeted June 18th or something. So there was speculation about that date. And I was joking with Wale. I'm like, yo, I'm about to, I wasn't joking, I was serious. He must have thought I was joking. I was like, yo, I'm about to move my album to his date. You know what I mean? Like, but at this time I didn't know it was confirmed. Like, I'm gonna move my album to his date. He gonna just drop a week before me. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm gonna move my album to his date. And Wale is like, yeah, please go ahead, nigga, so I can have June 25th, you know? So it was just the spirit I got. Like, yo, I couldn't pass up the opportunity.
And it paid off for J. Cole, who managed to make it to the top of the charts, surpassing even Yeezus with an album that is a departure from his basketball-themed projects. But don't let the title fool you.
It's Born Sinner, but it's actually not religious to me. You know what I mean? Like, yes, there's some choirs on the album, and then there's a play on questionable pastors. You know what I mean? And even a church choir, like a youth group choir, or whatever. But to me, Born Sinner, the word sinner is for everybody. Like, everybody, whether you believe in religion or not, like, sinner can apply to you. To me, a sin is knowing something is right, and then going against that. I look at it as a personal thing, like letting yourself down. It ain't necessarily about religion. Like, I'm not trying to preach to anybody on the album.
J. Cole doesn't preach, but he does explore his demons and takes some of the biggest names in the music industry along for the ride. After collaborating with hip-hop legend Missy Elliott on his previous album, for this new project, J. Cole called on R&B singer Miguel for the song Power Trip and Compton rapper Kendrick Lamar on the enchanting Forbidden Fruit. He also managed to rally the greatest female hip-hop group of the 90s, TLC. Those are the voices of T-Boz and Chilli here on his second single, Crooked Smile.
I was such a huge fan, and I remember just staring at the CD or the tape at the time, and just, I was a little boy, so I had a huge crush on these girls. But on top of the crush, what was even more important was the music. Like, they made incredible music. So when I made this song, Crooked Smile, and we had the hook, I was like, what if we got TLC to sing this? It seemed like a far-fetched thing, but it just so happened they was actually in working. You know what I mean? Like, they were working at the time and was down to do it. They heard the song, they loved it, and they were down to do it. So that's how the song came about.
They tell me I should fix my grill because I got money now. I ain't gonna sit around in front like I ain't thought about it. A perfect smile is more appealing, but it's funny how my joint is crooked. Look at how far I got without it. I keep my twisted grill just to show the kids it's real. We ain't picture perfect, but we worth the picture still.
I never worked on a song for as long as I worked on Crooked Smile. The theme of Crooked Smile is basically taking my flaws, which is the fact that I don't have no picture perfect Colgate model smile, you know what I mean? Yeah, I got some thick eyebrows. It's like taking these things about me that people might make fun of, you know what I mean? And twisting it and using it as ammo and empowering other people to do the same with their flaws, you know?
He may not have a perfect smile, but so-called flaws like this one are what make J. Cole who he is. An MC who follows his dreams and has well and truly surpassed his Roc Nation protege status. Far from the hype and bling-bling surrounding the rap game, this born storyteller will be kicking his What Dreams May Come tour off in Miami on the 10th of September alongside rapper Wale.
Beautiful, you can't be sure, 'cause he don't seem to want you best, and it's got you asking. So all you see is what you...